those Sundays when the context of the gospel lesson will open wide the windows of understanding. So I'm just going to jump right in. Stay with me. We're getting late in Matthew's gospel. The timing and progression of things becomes pretty important. Last week, we remember we heard the parable of the laborers in the vineyard, a story about God's rich, generous, abundant grace. Right after that, Jesus foretells his death a third and final time. Then comes Palm Sunday, that triumphant procession just 5 days before his crucifixion. Get it? We're just 5 days now before Jesus' crucifixion. And on Palm Sunday, Jesus gets on the back of a donkey and marches into the holy city. And the crowds line the streets and throw their garments in the streets to pave his way. Hosanna to the Son of David, they cry. And then after that procession, Jesus goes immediately to the temple. And he throws out the money changers. Perhaps the most violent and angry episode in Jesus' entire ministry. And so now comes this meeting with the religious leaders, this pivotal meeting. They are the head honchos, and their authority has been challenged. See, when the people lined the streets of Jerusalem and called out to Jesus, "Hail to the Son of David," these common people were making a political statement. They had a new leader, and it was not the Pharisees. Now, even though they misunderstood the nature of Jesus' leadership, still the authority of the establishment had been challenged. The Pharisees could feel their ironclad grip on power and authority start to drip between their fingers. And so when Jesus now goes to the temple and upsets the money changers' table, he's not just questioning their authority. Now he's also undermining their economic power. The money changers charge exorbitant prices to convert the pilgrims' foreign currency into currency that would be acceptable at the temple. And of course, the religious establishment got a cut of that. And so Jesus is now putting their revenue stream at risk in addition to their power. And get this, when Jesus overturns the tables and the crowds watch him, guess what they yell again? Hosanna to the Son of David. Matthew tells us that the chief priests and scribes were indignant. Yeah, I guess. At best, they were indignant. And so now, the religious leaders come to Jesus with this question that is designed to trap him. By what authority, they say, are you doing these things? Things like parading into Jerusalem like a conquering king, or throwing the money changers out of the temple. Who gives you this authority? And Jesus engages then in a little rhetorical gamesmanship. All right, you've got a question for me, I've got a question for you. You answer my question, I'll answer yours. Jesus' question had to do with his cousin John the Baptist, whose preaching was at least as controversial as Jesus. And John had been executed by the Jewish king. If the religious leaders were going to answer the question truthfully, it would demonstrate their disdain for John's message of repentance. The baptism of John, Jesus said, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from man? Mind drop. They refused to answer. Of course they refused to answer. How could they answer? And then so did Jesus refuse to answer. Well, sort of, he refused to answer. Actually, he did answer them, but not straight up. He answered them with a story. a story remarkable for its brevity and simplicity. It can be told in four sentences. A man with a vineyard had two sons. He asked two sons to go and work in the vineyard. One said no at first and then went and worked. The other said yes and then decided not to go. That's it. That's the whole story. The incriminating punchline comes, of course, from the question, which son did the will of the father? The one who went and worked, of course, even though he's the one who at first said no. See, what the religious authorities could not grasp, and what eventually got Jesus nailed to the cross, is that in Jesus, God was doing a new thing. The goodness of God was now being broken wide open for all the world to see and all the world to see to receive, even the tax collectors and prostitutes. The religious authorities had closed themselves off to these promptings of the Spirit, to the extraordinary expansiveness of the kingdom of God. The religious leaders were part of this long tradition who had once been faithful to the people of God, but who had now let their traditions, their past, their comfortable authority obscure what it meant to follow God. They were that son who gave lip service to the Father's invitation, but instead decided to stay home. Sometimes I worry about us, dear church. If Jesus kept butting up against the religious people of his day, is it true that that still happens? Are we the religious people who get a little nervous about God's call to follow him, about the demands of discipleship? Are we the ones who get so stuck in the ruts of how we've always done things that we miss the call of radical grace and radical service? Are we those leaders who get so comfortable with our safe, non-controversial, middle-class religion that we forget that our loyalty is to Jesus and not to a way of life? I worry about the church getting stuck in the past chains that bind us and keep us moving forward, keep us from moving forward. Believe me, I am so grateful for the past and for the traditions that we have received from those who have come before us. But the past is not going to save us. In Jesus, God keeps on inviting us into a new kingdom, a new way of life, a new way of living that has the capacity to shape every moment of our lives from this time forward. Every moment of our lives is pregnant with the possibility of receiving God's grace, of repenting for the wrongs we have done, of letting go of the wrongs that have been done to us, and of returning to a right relationship with God and a clear vision of the mission to which God calls us. And what might that mission be? And I can think of no better description of the new life than this grand hymn in the second lesson. Paul writes, "Do nothing out of selfish conceit. In humility, consider others as better than yourselves. Instead of watching out for your own good, watch out for the good of others. And have this mind among you that was also in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the very form of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be held on to with white knuckles. But he emptied himself and became human just like us. And then he went to the cross. He emptied himself and went to the cross. And therefore, Paul says, God highly exalted him and gave him that is the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow. The one who humbled himself and ascended the throne of the cross is the source of our life. The one who has forgiven our sins. The one who has shown us the face of the Father. And we see now that the Father is smiling at us. The one who has set us free from the past that has forgotten God. And the one who now gives us a hopeful future. Our God's work, our hands' day of service today is a sign that we are embracing a future in which we will be the church in this community. It thrills me to see us get out of this building and into the community. Don't get me wrong, this is a beautiful building. And you know I love what happens here on Sunday morning. I love worship, I love church. It's the highlight of my week. But this gathering is not where the story ends, it's where the story begins. What happens here must get lived out in our lives as we go out those doors and into the world. The point of the church is not to gather into a building, but to be sent from the building into the world, to be the body of Christ. And so many of us this morning, we'll go out from here and engage in acts of service. Now, I know that in some sense it's symbolic. An hour and a half of work. Maybe it's not going to change much. Cleaning up a few trails, painting a garage at Scandia, sorting some linens at Bargains. But signs and symbols mean something. And what we do today is the sign of a small steps from which great things grow, the seeds of the future into which God has called us. Our life, dear church, is in Jesus. Jesus and nothing else. Our life is in Jesus. And that is a particularly important word for people who are tempted to find life in religion and not in Jesus. In this word, in the remembrance of our baptism, in the bread and wine at the table, God has once again rekindled our faith and our life in Jesus. As a sign of our life, of our loyalty, and of our allegiance first to Him, we bow our knees in humility and gratitude and in praise, and then we get up off our knees and go into the world.